So I would like to talk about one of the most beautiful success of mathematics in physics, in theoretical physics, or in mathematical physics in some sense, which is the reduction of the problem of the classification of elementary particles to a purely mathematical problem, very abstract in some sense, via the use of space-time symmetries. So it's really, well, for any theoretical physicist, one of the things that we love is that, in some sense, physics is the place where the universe expresses its beauty in mathematical terms. It's even one way that we can define physics in some sense. It has always been a matter of surprise and wonders, and also inspiration that mathematics applies so well to describe the physical universe. So I will talk mostly about a result that has been done by Eugen Wigner. It's a Hungarian physicist who got Nobel Prize in 1963, for his contribution to the applications of the symmetry principles in both atomic physics and in elementary particles physics. Eugen Wigner wrote a paper about what he called the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in natural sciences, because he even called it a miracle, something that we neither a gift from the universe, that we neither understand nor deserve, but that we should really enjoy and appreciate fully. Okay, so in practice, so I would like to talk about the classification of elementary particles via space-time symmetry. So maybe I should first start by reminding you what are the symmetries of space-time, more precisely of empty space-time, in the case where I have a single particle moving in space-time. That's the idea. Okay, so first of all, we have translation symmetries of space-time, which means that all points in space-time, so all events in empty space-time, are equal with respect to each other. So that's translation symmetry in space-time. Then there is another important symmetry, which is rotation symmetry in space. So all directions in space are the same. And also very important is the fact that all directions in space-time, in some subtle sense, are equal as well. More precisely, this is called the relativity principle, that we can take two observers which are in uniform motion with respect to each other. They experience, they measure, the measurements are the same, they have the same laws of physics. They observe the same laws of physics when they do experiments. So this is the setting, these are the space-time symmetries. Now, how to apply them? So, how to apply them? First of all, we should realize that we should combine two important descriptions of modern theoretical physics. One is microscopic world. It is governed by the laws of quantum mechanics. And two important things in quantum mechanics are the following. The first important thing is the wave-particle duality, that particles are also waves. Of course, it's a very abstract wave. It's not like a wave. It's a sort of wave like the wave on the surface of water, or things like this, or the acoustic wave, which are movements of the air that reach us to provide the sound. It's something more abstract, but still it's a wave. And an important property of linear waves is what is called the superposition principle. So if two waves meet each other, they just superpose each other. So it's the superposition principle. And in more technical terms, more mathematical terms, we call it linearity principle. So that's the first important thing. And then there's also another very important fact in quantum mechanics. It's the fact that the laws of quantum mechanics are intrinsically probabilistic. So there is no determinism. We cannot predict what will happen, the best we can do is to compute the probabilities of what can happen. So that's a very important thing. Probabilities are at the core of quantum mechanics. They will not produce the position of particles in the future, just the probability to observe, for instance, particles at a given place, at a given time. Okay, so these are the two important properties of quantum mechanics. Now, what are the important properties of the macroscopic world? In that case, the ones we need are just the space-time symmetries that I mentioned before. Okay, so the idea of Wigner is try to combine the principle of quantum mechanics, so microscopic world, with the principle of relativity and the other space-time symmetries, so the properties of the macroscopic world. Now, concretely, using mathematics, how can you combine these two properties, so both the laws of quantum mechanics and the space-time symmetries? Well, this is a complicated story. It makes use of what is called in a mathematical jargon group theory and representation theory. So in practice, just to say a few words for the one that might have heard it once, you reduce the problem of classifying particles to the problem, to the mathematical problem of classification of what are called unitary irreducible representations. But let me give just more idea of what does that mean. So the first property was this linearity property, that if you sum two waves, the sum of these two is still a good wave. So this is the linearity, so the linear world. So it's, you have what is called a linear representation. Anyway. Another important property is that you want to preserve probabilities when you do space-time symmetries. So the probability to find particles somewhere in the universe should be conserved. It can be at a different point under the space-time symmetry, but the sum of probabilities, for instance, should be preserved. And this property, in mathematical terms, in this context, is called unitarity. So this is the why I said unitary representation. So linearity is for representation, unitarity is you conserve probabilities, and then I also use the word irreducible. So irreducible is the fact that you want to consider just elementary particles. So by elementary particles, we mean particles which are not made of more elementary particles, more fundamental particles. Like we know, for instance, protons are not elementary, they are made out of quarks, for instance. But quarks themselves supposedly are elementary. They are not made of something. Okay, so again, there is a mathematical way to phrase this in a very, very precise way. It's this property of irreducibility, which is, by the way, not exactly equivalent, it's even more subtle than the fact of being elementary or not in terms of, it's more well-defined, let's say. Let us see a bit more concretely what does it mean for elementary particles, maybe in more familiar terms. What does this classification by Wigner, both mathematics and the reduction of the problem to mathematics is due to Wigner, but what does it mean maybe more concretely? So, there are two important things that you may apply the space-time symmetry. So a first important way to apply space-time symmetries is that if you start with a particle here and now, by using translation symmetry, you can map it to a particle, the same particle, but let's say at a different point at a different time. So this means by making use of space-time symmetries, you can describe the motion of particles at later time, at different place. So you can relate all these different probabilities of finding the particle at different place and time by using just space-time symmetries. That's already a radical simplification by making use of space-time symmetries. Okay, that's the first one. But then, if you remember, a very important thing about symmetries are not only what changes, it's also what remains invariant. So, if you want to classify particles, you should also look for what is invariant. Okay, consider, for instance, a particle that goes at a speed, not the speed of light, just another speed, so lesser than the speed of light. We call them massive particles. Why? Because if you go at a, if you consider a particle moving in empty space-time at a given speed, you can always consider the observer that goes exactly at the same speed in the same direction along this particle. And if you look at this particle, for him, the particle is at rest. Like two trains that go at the same speed, they look at rest with respect to each other. So this means that there is always what we call a rest frame. The lab frame, sometimes it is called, where you see the particle at rest. And in that case, you can measure the energy of the particle in this frame. And if you make use of the relation well-known E equal mc squared, that tells you that energy is related to the mass, then by measuring energy in this frame, you can measure what is called the rest mass. The mass for the particle when you are, when the particle is at rest. Okay, so that's one property, but now it's not over, because still in this rest frame, you can do rotations. And still the particle is invariant, it's not changed. So this means now that you should look at the different representations, again it's something more abstract, the classification of how the rotations will be described. And in that case you are led to another property of particles, much more mysterious, if you are not in quantum mechanics, which is called the spin. It's the intrinsic angular momentum, the way that it rotates in some sense around itself, in this rest frame. So this is the spin. Okay. But now you may wonder, okay, but there are also particles that go at the speed of light, like, well, photons, light, okay, the particles of which light is made of. So in that case, there is no such rest frame, because since under, that's the relativity principle, I mean, part of the relativity principle, that the speed of light is the same for everyone. No observer can see a photon at rest. Even two photons along each other, they see each other going at the speed of light. Okay, so in other words, there is no rest mass. There is no notion of rest mass for a photon, or some particle going at the speed of light. In that case, we say that they are massless. In some sense, their rest mass is zero. That's what we say. So that's one property. And then, since you cannot go in the rest frame, the best you can do is to go along the particle motion. And so now the only rotations that you can do are along their directions. So just along the transverse plane. And in that case, you have to characterize. So I will just take an example. You can characterize particles like you could characterize cards by, for instance, the order of the rotation symmetry in the plane of the card, for instance. So, for instance, we would say here that if I do a half turn, and the card remains invariant, and for the particle it would be the same, then we would say that this particle has spin 2, like the hypothetical constituent of gravity. The gravitons are supposed to be of spin 2. Well, if you have to do a complete turn, this would be like a photon because it has order 1, it has spin 1, helicity 1, we call it. Okay, so as we can say, all particles, all elementary particles, are characterized just by two numbers, their mass and their spin, or sometimes called the helicity in this context. So, and this is really one of the remarkable success of mathematical physics, and unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in physics.